Springdale, how we doing? Are we good? As you can tell, we're a little bit different this morning. Today is what we are calling Legacy Sunday, where we are highlighting our 10-year vision to reach Northwest Arkansas, America, and the world for Jesus Christ. One of the four lanes of love, we're calling it our decade of love. One of the four lanes of love, L-O-V-E, is legacy. We are going to do everything in our power for the next decade to reach the next generation with the gospel of Jesus Christ. We have already seen God do some incredible things, and we're going to continue to run in that vein. You may not know this, but every week on Sunday and during the week, we have next generation, we have next gen worship services happening all over our church. And there are people who are consistently helping lead worship in those venues. And so what we thought we'd do today for Legacy Sunday is invite some of those people to come and help us lead worship today. So will you make welcome some of our next gen worship leaders and our Cross Kids Worship Choir.
With me.
In Scripture, you actually never tell children to be more like adults. You tell adults to be more like children. So God, would we take our cues from those behind us today and worship you uninhibited in this place? Come on, sing it, church. You are here. Yes. Moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are here. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here. I worship you. I worship you.
Come on, every voice in the room, sing it.
You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are.
Yes, sing it in faith, I know.
Way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. Never stop.
Oh, come on, just in your heart right now, I just want you to think about something that God has shown himself to you this week. Everyone just bow your head, close your eyes in this place, and in your heart, I just want you to imagine something that God has shown to you this week about his character, and praise him for that thing. Thank him for it. I know who you are, God, and I know. Yes, we believe you are all things. You are the great and mighty God. You are the great and mighty God. Even the breath in my lungs I have is a gift from you. I praise you with it, Lord. Oh, yes. Lord Jesus, what a gift even to praise you this morning, Lord. Thank you for the breath that we have in our lungs, God, to praise you. And Lord, as we sing to you this morning, I pray that this would be a pleasing sound to your ears, young and old alike, joining our voices in unison to declare your greatness together. Would you be praised and worshiped in this place? In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.
You get life. You are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore.
say that is cool right there. Thank you. You may be seated, and thank all of you for leading us today. What a fantastic job you did. And welcome to this Legacy Sunday at Cross Church. Well, today, this week, we celebrate Veterans Day, and we would not want to miss the opportunity this morning to thank those of you that have served in the armed forces. So if you have are presently serving in the armed forces or have served in the armed forces, would you please stand right now that our church can give you the welcome and honor you deserve. That's right. Thank you so much. You may be seated, and just know from our hearts to yours, we thank you for keeping us free. Thank you so very much. Our church loves you dearly. Well, today we've been praying and thinking and asking God to give us a word for today, for this Legacy Sunday. And it's been amazing to see what the Lord has done in year one of the Decade of Love. And Pastor Nick will share some more about that in a moment. And I can't wait to hear you here. I've already heard it once at Fayetteville today. For you to hear what's to come, I want us to have our ears open to the Spirit of the Lord as He works through His man today and as He shares with us through our pastor what is next in the Decade of Love. You've been so incredibly faithful. You are a great church. I'm going to tell you, you're a great church, and you're so generous. And your generosity has allowed us to see God do some incredible things, not just this year, but for at least the decades I know about, at least about three decades, I've seen time after time after time. When God's people come together, it's amazing what we can do when we're together. I want us to pray across the room this morning and pray for Pastor as he comes in just a moment. Would you just take a moment and thank the Lord for your church? Don't take it for granted. Thank you, Lord, for the privilege of being in your presence today, and what an honor it is to witness the generations coming together on this platform to declare the mercies of the Lord. And your praise shall continually be in our mouth, both now and forevermore. Amen. We thank you for the privilege today of coming and hearing one more time about your work. And Lord, this day is about you. This day is not about money. This day is not about a man. This day is about the kingdom of God. And so I pray in Jesus' name, you would use the man of God, our pastor, to share with us what's on his heart that has come from you. And may we respond accordingly today as you have put in our heart. We're so very grateful for the privilege of being under your teaching today. In Jesus' name, amen.
If we want to do the Decade of Love together, this journey is going to take every one of us. We have a plan to plant 10 churches. We'll plant 20 if we can. We have a plan to send 50 missionaries. We'll send 100 if we can. We have a plan to position the church in a certain manner. We'll do more if we can. We can move at the speed of our generosity. We want to do all that we can over the next 10 years to reach the next generation and to position the church for the future. Well, welcome to church, everybody. It is so good to have all of you here in the room at Springdale, and we are joined via video at the Pinnacle Hill service as well as the Fayetteville service. Everybody here at Springdale, can we welcome the rest of our church? We are glad to have everybody here today across the campuses. This is one of those unique days where we all link up across video. We do this a few times a year, and especially on big days like this. And I really wanted to get the opportunity to speak to the entire church. So I began the day at the 8 a.m. at Fayetteville, which, just FYI, the Holy Spirit is still awake at 8 o'clock in the morning. And we had a great service down there. Then I drove here at 9:30. We'll go to the 11 o'clock at Pinnacle Hills. And man, we're going to have a great, great day together. If you got a Bible, I want you to grab it. Turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. I'm going to get there in just a moment. If you're brand new to our church today, Let me kind of set up the day of why it's like this. This is a different kind of day entirely, and this is called Legacy Sunday. We're going to take a look back at all that the Lord has done over the last 12, 13 months and celebrate that together, as well as look ahead to the future. And if you are brand new to our church, this honestly is a great day for you to come and just get to hear what the Lord is doing in this church to make a difference in the world. We don't expect anything out of you other than just to have a great day and sit back and relax and listen. For our regular attenders and members, we have been talking about this day for several weeks now. At the end of our service, all of us will have the opportunity to give towards a special offering specifically towards the Decade of Love, and I'll talk about that here in just a moment. There are two questions that you might be asking, and if I were in your shoes, I'd be asking these same two questions. Number one, what is the Decade of Love? And number two, why are we taking up a special offering towards it? Okay, so let me try to answer those two very quickly, especially if you're brand new or you're new-ish to the church. The Decade of Love is simply our 10-year vision of how we're going to go about reaching Northwest Arkansas, America, and the world for Jesus Christ, okay? That has been our mission as a church for several decades now. That has not changed. The Decade of Love is basically the how of how we're going to do that over the next 10 years together. Let me quickly refresh your memory on the L-O-V-E. The L stands for legacy. It's what we're talking about a lot today. We want to do all that we can in our power and in the power of God to reach the next generation and to prepare the church for the future. The O stands for obedience to Christ's commission. We want to reach people locally and around the world with the gospel of Jesus. We have a goal of planting 10 churches in strategic cities in America and around the world. We want to send 50 missionaries from our church, send them out. Here's the cool thing, 13 months in, we've already sent 8 of the 50 in year one, which is a really praise God moment there. And we want to send 2,000 people on mission trips somewhere around the world. With COVID moving into what appears to be a new season, this becomes even more of a reality. The V stands for vulnerable. We want to be a church that loves the vulnerable among us. We want to meet their spiritual and their physical needs. Sounds a lot like the Bible right there. We want to focus on the poor, the hungry, the sick, the immigrant, and the prisoner. And the E stands for equipping and encouraging pastors and missionaries. God has written an amazing story here at Cross Church. We are 151 years old. Isn't that cool? Everybody, we celebrate the 150 big, but 151 is also really cool, okay? And so God's done a lot in 151 years of history, and we just want to pour into other churches, pour into other pastors and missionaries. We are not in competition with other churches. We have a kingdom mindset. We are on the same team. We want to help them. So that's what the Decade of Love is, very quickly. Number two, why are we giving a special offering towards the Decade of Love? Let me give you a few reasons. Number one is stewardship, the aspect of stewardship. We firmly believe what the Bible teaches about biblical generosity. We teach it. We practice it personally. We believe in tithing. We believe in going above and beyond in moments of generosity. And over the years, we have given above and beyond the tithe towards several things. Every one of the buildings that you're sitting in today, so here at Springdale, there at Fayetteville, and there at Pinnacle Hills, those were special times where the church rose up and said, you know what, we're going to go above and beyond to reach more people with the good news of Jesus. And we gave a special offering towards that sometime in a moment, sometimes over a period of years. And we want to do that again today. Our plan is to make this an annual offering where we just do this this time around of the year, and we're excited about that. Let me speak spiritually to you about this. Greed is very natural, okay? It's very normal for me. I would assume it's normal for you to try to hold on with clenched fists to what we have in our hands. Generosity is supernatural. When God opens our hands and we say, Lord, I want to live for a higher purpose than just possessions and money, that's the spiritual work that God does in our hearts. And some people will give today above and beyond. Some of our people have been giving all year long over and above their tithes towards the Decade of Love. Both are great on-ramps to generosity today. So we're giving just for the element, the biblical principle of stewardship today, but also for a word that I'll just say is acceleration. Acceleration. I want to be clear here today, okay? So when Meredith and I give of our tithes to the church, When we give 10% of all that God gives us back to the ministry budget of the church, which we always say is the lifeblood of the church, when we do that, when you do that, you are giving towards the decade of love. So I want to make no mistake about that. If you've been tithing, you've been giving to the ministry budget, over the last 13 months, you have given to see the decade of love fulfilled. Last December, we got out of debt, and so most of what has been used towards going to debt is now distributed among the four lanes of love that I just described. So you are already giving towards the decade of love if you are a giver here at the church. But here's what I want us to understand today. It's true for every campus. We can move at the speed of our generosity together. You just heard me say it in the video from, I don't know when they took that from, but I said it at some point. And we have a plan to reach and plant 10 churches. We'll plant more if there's funds there. We have a goal to reach the vulnerable. We'll do more if there's money there. We want to position the church for the future in a certain manner, but we'll do more if there is money there. Now, if you don't get anything else today, I want you to get what I'm about to say. I believe there are aspects of the decade of love that we could have never dreamed about that will come to fruition because God's people gave and it accelerated the vision beyond what we ever thought possible. So listen to this. What happens in this room today will allow us to say yes to something in the future that we have no idea about presently. Isn't that cool how the Lord works? So God's people will give today. My family will give today, and 2.5 years from now, God will throw an opportunity before us, and we are positioned not to think or pray about it. We are positioned to say, absolutely yes. Let's do it together for the glory of God. And so if you have been here for several years, we do several special offerings throughout the year. Around May, June, we give towards camp scholarships. This time of year, we normally give towards blessing baskets. Well, guess what? We're going to try to do all of these special offerings in one offering towards the vision of the church, one decade of love offering annually that we do. Now, I want you to look at 2 Corinthians chapter 5. As you've probably gathered by this point, today is not a normal sermon. We're going to talk a lot about just vision of what God's done, what God, we believe, has for us in the future. But I do want us to open in the Word of God together, and this is such a great passage for where we're at. Look at verse 14 and 15. The Bible says this, for the love of Christ controls us. I would encourage you to underline or circle that word. Because we have concluded this, that one has died for all, therefore all have died, and he died for all, that those who might live might no longer live for themselves, but for him who for their sake died and was raised. You think about that word control, it has the idea of holding something together. So we are held together by the love that Christ has for us, and we are compelled to do some things about it. Think about the connection here. We are controlled by the love of Christ because we believe that Jesus died for all people so that all people might live through him. Do we believe that today, church? Like, if we don't believe anything else, we believe that Jesus Christ died for all and all can find life in him. Many people hear the idea of love and they often think, well, that's soft on truth. It's just wishy-washy and I'm a truth person. Well, listen, here the Bible inseparably links them together. We love because we are controlled by the truth of the gospel that Jesus really did die and Jesus really did rise from the dead. Love and truth don't go separate, they go hand in hand. It is the truth of the gospel that controls us. So I want to play that out today. I want to express how has God played out that passage through this group of people called our church, called Cross Church. How has that played out over the last year? And how do we believe that God wants us to play that out over the next year to several years that are right in front of us? So I want to go back through the L-O-V-E. I'm going to tell you some things that are going to make you very happy, very proud to be a part of our church, and give you an opportunity to give major glory to the Lord in heaven. Let's talk about legacy first of all. When we got debt-free last December, one of the very first things we set out to do was to invest in the next generation at each one of our campuses. And we did that by making an addition and improvement on every one of our campuses in renovation. So what you see right here on the screens, we did this at Springdale. This was the most significant renovation of all of them. We had not really touched our next gen space in a good 10 or so years. And what you see now is the Fayetteville Playground, the very first outdoor playground Fayetteville has ever had in 10 years. Right there on the screen is Pinnacle Hills. That one is actually kind of still in process right now, just refreshing that, give it just a new look, and we're very, very excited about that. Here's the great thing, because of your generosity to the ministry budget, we did all this with cash and debt-free. Praise be to God. That's awesome. The other side of this legacy component is preparing the church for the future. And I don't know, it may just be unique to me because of my role in the church as a senior pastor, although I'm sure many of you share the same burden. But it's upon me as the pastor to do all that I can to help prepare the church for the future in a financial manner. And we have done several things over the last year. Buster's role is specifically tied to that and creating a legacy team. Those of you who have the gift of giving, who say, Nick, I love to give to the kingdom of God, that you would be a part of this and help us accelerate the vision moving forward. And so I just want you to understand that we as a staff, alongside of our pastor's council, which in our church government is a group of laymen and staff who surround me in all matters related to finances in our church. And here's what I want you to know. I hope this encourages you. We are handling your money that you give to us in a certain way to prepare not only for the present, but also for the future. We are intentionally creating space to be able to say yes to things in the future that we don't even know about in the present time. Now, one of the things that we're giving today, as we think about reaching the next generation, as we think about all of that, when you give to the Decade of Love offering today, you are giving towards camp scholarships. Every single May and June, we ask you, would you like to help send a kid to camp? That helps some kids go to camp on full scholarship. Others get to go on reduced price there. And we never want money to stay in the way of anybody going to camp. If there's one way we have reached kids and students for decades in this church, it has been through summer camp. And we will continue to do that for as long as I'm the pastor here, okay? Interesting thing that happened not too long ago, 2 weeks ago, I led the pastor's conference of the Arkansas Baptist State Convention. It was in Cabot, Arkansas. Any Cabot people in the house today? Okay, like three of you. Welcome. Welcome to church. And so we went to Cabot, and I held a lunch there before the conference started. It was about 200 people just around round tables, and I interviewed one of our speakers, and we were talking about reaching the next generation. And I asked this group, think about this. This is pastors and church leaders from their churches in Arkansas all gathered together. And I said, how many of you were reached either as a kid or as a teenager? 90%+ of their hands went up. So you've heard the stats before of how important it is to reach people before they reach the age of 18. And can I just reiterate, we got to do all we can to reach kids and students while they are under our homes and while they're under the umbrella of our church family. And one of the cool things that we get to do that is just the next group above 18 and down is our college ministry. And our Fayetteville campus, as you're watching there, we are located literally two turns from the campus. We are 5 minutes from the University of Arkansas. Every Wednesday night, we have hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of college students that enter into that worship center, and they hear the gospel and hear the word of God. And one of the things we're giving towards today is an event we do in August called C3, that's the name of the college ministry, at the Greek Theater, which is right on campus. And this year we had right at 1,900 college students come to that and hear the gospel. And so I'm gonna ask Luke Harper to come up here. Luke is our college pastor. Welcome to the Springdale campus here today and everybody else watching. Luke, why don't you tell them a little bit more about C3 at the Greek and what their generosity has the opportunity to do?
Yeah, church, every single year, the last Wednesday in August is the first week of school for all the college students getting back. We host a service in the amphitheater on campus called the Greek Theater. And just like Nick said, we have somewhere between 1,500 to 2,000 college students meet there on that Wednesday night every single year. And it is so incredible to see students running into their fraternity houses and just inviting all their fraternity brothers to come join them. And just students coming down from the dorms like, what is that down there? And they just end up there. And for the last several years that we've done this, we've seen hundreds of college students come to faith in Christ. And it has been such a cool thing. There's so many stories we tell from the baptistry that start with, I walked out of my dorm, saw a bunch of people at the Greek Theater, and decided to join, and Jesus radically changed their life. And when we end up in conversations with freshmen just 2 months later, like, hey, man, how'd you get connected to Cross Church? How'd you end up here? He said, man, I heard about the Greek Theater night, and I walked down, and I realized there was a church family here for me in Fayetteville. So today, church, as you give your gift to the Decade of Love offering, what you're doing is you are setting up us an opportunity to introduce people to a way, to a new life where literal generations can change. That men and women will walk down to the Greek Theater this next year, and there will be different husbands, wives, mothers, and fathers as a result of what happens at just hosting a worship service in an outdoor amphitheater at the University of Arkansas. And so thank you so much. I stand here on behalf of future college students whose lives will be changed because of what's given today. So thank y'all so much.
That's awesome. Thank you, Luke. You know, here's my encouragement to you today. If you feel like, man, that burdens your heart, man, give to the Decade of Love offering. And it costs money to rent the facility. It costs money to have lights come in and all that we have to do. So you're a part of that. And here's what I would encourage you. Not only give, but next August when it comes around, I want you to make your way to the University of Arkansas campus, and I want you to just stand on the outskirts of the amphitheater, because if you go in the end skirts, you feel really old, okay? But just stand on the outside, and you'll see almost 2,000 college students hearing the word of God and hearing the gospel. It'll grip your heart. It really will. That's the L, okay? It's what we're giving towards in the legacy component of this. Let's talk about the O. I'm very, very excited about this one. This is obedience to Christ's commission. And let me teach you church for just a moment, okay? There are many churches that don't have a balanced approach to missions. Well, our mission statement is written intentionally off Acts 1:8, where we want to reach people in Northwest Arkansas, America, and the world. It's not just one of those three, it's all three together. Many people, they may reach a lot of people locally, but they don't do anything across the world. Or vice versa, they may do something, they may do a lot across the world in missions, but they've not seen anybody saved and baptized in their church in a year. We want to be a balanced church and a balanced approach there. Pastor Johnny Hunt once said it this way, I love this. He says, the light that shines the furthest shines the brightest at home. So if we want to be a missions type of church, it starts with reaching people right here in Northwest Arkansas. That will always be the first part of this mission right here. And thankfully, we've seen the Lord do that over the last year. I don't want us to just run by all that we've seen God do, because we've seen absolute revival the last year. Can I rewind it for you? We were praying for God to do a major work on May 2nd. We brought Robbie Gallaty in, remember that? That Wednesday night, Pastor Luke, who was just up here, a college pastor, April 28th, stood up in a room of hundreds of college students, shared the gospel, gave them an opportunity to be immediately baptized, and 32 college students were baptized just like that. That bled into four or five days later when we all gathered in these rooms, and Pastor Robbie, again, shared the gospel, gave people an opportunity to be baptized immediately. And if you were here, you remember the Spirit of God was here more than anybody was here. And we saw 211 people be baptized in one day. Never seen that ever before in my life. You say, well, Nick, what has God done since then? Since April 28th, we have seen 772 people be baptized at our church. There's those first few weeks and months were just crazy as God just began to move and Jesus was just doing so much in the life of our church. But maybe you've wondered this question like I've wondered it. Is the revival over? Is the revival over? Can I just give you some info? Last Sunday across all of our campuses, we baptized 12 more people. And if you take our church calendar kicks off on kickoff Sunday in August. And last year, from kickoff to this point in the year, we baptized 42 people. This year to this point, this Sunday, 127 people have been baptized. So God is continuing to work. Last September, we announced our intention to plant 10 churches in strategic cities all over the world. We had no idea who the planters would be or where the cities would be. And God has already allowed us to plant two and partner with two churches. We have Redeemer Queens Park in London, England. And then we have the church in Denver, Colorado with Pastor Doug Hickson up there. And today, one of the most exciting things we get to announce today is the location of our third church plant. But before we do that, we got to rewind the story of our own church about 20 to 22 years for you to understand the full big picture of what God's doing. Let's turn our attention to the screen.
Hi, I'm Pastor John of the Keystone Fellowship in the greater Philadelphia area called City of Brotherly Love. I'm coming to you today because of just your impact upon my life, upon my family's life, and upon this church's life. And I got the impact as serving there as your student pastor for about 8 years in the 90s. Yeah, in the 90s. Pastor Nick Floyd and Pastor Ryan, they were students. They were little sixth and seventh graders, but look what they're doing now. And I want to say thank you from the bottom of my heart too, because not only did you make an impact while I was there, but you've made an impact here. See, when God called us to Philadelphia, we knew we needed partners. We knew we needed someone to come alongside and help us. And you did that. I remember when we came up here and there was nobody part of a group, no Bible study, we didn't know anyone. And I knew we needed a lot of prayer. So I called Pastor Ronnie with that. I said, Ronnie, would you commit to pray for us and what we're doing here for the next year? And Ronnie said, yes, no doubt I'll do that. I didn't know that for several months later, he would call again and say, not only have I been praying for you, but we are committed to come alongside you financially, and we want to send some teams up. And you guys did that. And because of what you did in that partnership back in 2001, 2002, not only is there one church here in the greater Philly area, but six, and we're looking at going to church number seven here very, very soon. But I want to say congratulations to Pastor Nick and the Cross Church family there, because I know that you have a theme, an initiative, a great commission. It's called the Decade of Love. And I know your goal is to start 10 churches over the next 10 years. I know that you've already started a church in London, England. You started a church in Denver, Colorado. And I understand you're about to start a third church. You guys are going to come alongside and start a church in one of the fastest growing, most diverse cities in America. And I want to say again, I believe this. I believe you guys are going to do more than 10 churches in the next 10 years. God bless you, and shalom from the City of Brotherly Love.
What a great story that is, and Pastor John alluded to it. So without further ado, I'm happy to announce to you that our third church plant will be found in the city of Orlando, Florida, right there. Love that. Watch that over and over this week. It's just great. Now, I want you to get the full picture, okay? So let's put up a map here. Let me give you a picture. This church in Northwest Arkansas had the vision to plant another church in Philadelphia 20 years ago. All the way up there, our third church planter is coming from Philadelphia to Orlando, Florida. And so here's what you got to understand. This church that we're about to plant is a grandchild church of Cross Church. We planted the parent, and now they're birthing a baby all the way down in Orlando, Florida. But it gets even better, because our third church planter is here today. He is the son of John Cope. Would you help me welcome to the stage J.D. Cope here today? Well, this is really cool. So J.D. was a part, obviously, during when his parents were on staff here, J.D. was a part of this church. I believe we have another picture of me, Ryan, and J.D. here. Look at this. This is Ryan to the left, me with a sweet bowl cut in the middle. John Bodenstein, I saw you up here at Springdale. There you are. And then J.D. here on the end. This was, you look at the bottom left, November 11th, of 93, so 28 years ago next week.
I think that's before I got kicked out of boys choir.
Yeah, that probably was. And so, church, before I even ask him a few questions, think about this. When we talk about legacy and reaching the next generation, we're playing the long game here. It's the beauty of the local church. 20 plus years ago, some of y'all were teaching JD in Sunday school, still had the scars to prove it.
Yep.
And now he's our church planner. Just a really cool thing. So JD, talk about, of all things, why Orlando? People just think about Disney and...
Well, yeah, Disney, and you can read the back of that when you want.
It says Hurricane, which was my old football name. That's beautiful.
Figured you'd appreciate it. You can put that up in your office.
That's good. That's good. I like that. That's good.
So Orlando, you think of Disney, you think of Universal, SeaWorld, all the other things there. But what a lot of people don't realize is that this city is exploding with growth. To the point where you all in Northwest Arkansas have experienced immense growth. You're already over 500,000 people. But I want you to imagine a city now where over the last 10 years, the entire population of Northwest Arkansas has moved to that city. It's grown by over 500,000 people. And now it's become one of the ninth most unchurched cities in America, one of the sixth most de-churched areas. It's people that have left the church areas in the country. From my house, you can drive within a mile and a half, and you can hit a mosque, you can hit a synagogue, and you can hit a Hindu temple. But you have to drive at least 5 miles before you hit the closest evangelical church. There's just a ton of lostness, and so that's why we felt like Orlando needed to be the place.
That's really cool. So the name of the church is going to be So Church, S-O.
Yeah, we're not sewing.
There's, yeah, so yeah. So explain why the name.
Yeah, growing up here and in my household, if you do anything, you better have a purpose to it. You better have a reason to it. I'm sitting there, okay, God, why in the world do you want a church here? And why do you want us to exist? And immediately God brought to my mind this, look, Satan has come to this area to steal, kill, and destroy. But I have come, John 10:10 says, and in the CSB it says, so that they may have life. And so the reason that we are going to exist as a church is so this area of people will have life.
That's great. It's really cool. So talk about, yeah, we can clap for that for sure. Talk about how their generosity will make a difference today.
Yeah. So this is a city of dreamers. Like, everybody's always dreaming of the next thing in Orlando, and we believe that God has dreams for us as a church. I was here a little over 20 years ago, and your dad shared a message. It became my life verse out of Joshua chapter 1. It says, wherever the sole of your foot will tread, behold, I've already given you the land. And so we believe that God already has some dreams that we don't know about yet, and you're going to be giving towards those dreams. But we do know some things. We're going to need some places for us to actually meet and gather as a church. Yeah. We know that we're going to need kids ministry supplies. We know we're going to get into the schools and try to bless the teachers and the administration in those schools, and we're going to try to do some events out in the community to meet families that don't know Christ, that don't have a church, so that we can get them plugged in.
It's really cool. Yeah. Well, it is our goal today to fully fund our commitment. We are committed, I think, for 4 to 5 years. I'm not sure what that number is, but it's a significant financial contribution. I am aware of that number. And so we are wanting to do all that we can to fully fund that today. And JD, I did not give you something for the 8 o'clock service, but we got a little surprise for JD. Y'all ready for this? JD, on behalf of this church, not associated with your other money that we're going to be sending your way, but here's the first $10,000 for So Church right here. Take the Mickey Mouse ears back. Well, church, again, it's because of your generosity that we can just say, yes, let's give towards this church who's not even planted yet, but is about to start. So let's talk about the V, okay? The V stands for vulnerable. Our ministry at Feed the 479 has exploded due to COVID, as you can imagine. And I'm gonna say a number that you're gonna hear me say, you're gonna say, there's no way that that's real. These are facts straight from Feed the 479. Over the last year, we have fed 138,937 individuals through that ministry, which is a praise God. We've just been able to allow people the last few months back into the store. And part of that journey is we sit down and share the gospel with these people when they come to get groceries. We've already seen 7 people come to faith in Christ, which is really cool. One of the aspects of the vulnerable that all of us are burdened about, as you've watched the news over the last 2 or 3 months, has just been what's going on in Afghanistan. We've mentioned this somewhere the last few weeks. And there are people fleeing the country right now, and they're going to all different kinds of places in the world. And part of what this offering will go today is we will send a check directly to what is called Send Relief. Send Relief is our Southern Baptist Convention relief effort, and they are on the grounds ministering to Afghan refugees right now. We'll also hold part of this money back to be able to minister personally to Afghan refugees right here in our own state, in our own community. And one of the local things we're doing, obviously 2 weeks from today, we will have blessing baskets. Now, for the last 29 years, we have given away Thanksgiving meals and shared the gospel with a lot of people, and it's so routine in our church. I don't want us to miss it and just brush by it. 2 weeks from today, we will have 1,600 families come onto one of these three campuses, and we will not only get to feed them, but to share the gospel of Jesus Christ with them. That's amazing. It's amazing. Every single year, if you've never served at Blessing Baskets, man, you need to bring you and your family to Blessing Baskets 2 weeks from today. It'll change so much about your life and your perspective there. But every November, we ask you to give towards it. Sponsor a Blessing Basket. And this is a part of the Decade of Love offering. When you give today to the Decade of Love offering, you will be giving towards Blessing Baskets. To give you perspective on what it takes for our church to pull off Blessing Baskets, this rises a few thousand dollars depending on food cost, but I'll give you a middle range. It's about $80,000 for us to do Blessing Baskets every year, and so thank you for your generosity in helping us towards that. I'll wrap up with the E. The E stands with equipping and encouraging pastors and missionaries. The most surprising thing to me throughout the last year has been how many of you that this has struck a chord with your own heart. And it makes me so proud to be your pastor that you do have a kingdom mindset and you have a heart for other pastors and missionaries, other churches that you'll never even attend, but you just love and want to care for them. And this is our plan to help invest in smaller churches around our community and around the country. We've created what we are calling the Cross Church Partner Family of churches, where they remain totally independent, totally autonomous, but we just come into a relationship with them and say, listen, how can we help you in your church? How can we help you reach more people? Do you need help learning about children's ministry? Do you need help in the policies and procedures area? Do you need help with sermons or graphics? What do you need help with? We will do our best to help them. So we actually just recently opened this up for churches to apply and for them to get accepted by us. There's certain criteria. And to this day, this is really cool. We have already had 22 churches become a part of our Cross Church partner family. And listen to where they're from. They're from 12 states and one other nation, places like Florida, New York, Ohio, California, Utah, Virginia, and beyond. We are reaching from coast to coast through the partner family. And my favorite one was number 22. 2 weeks ago, I'm at the Arkansas Baptist Convention, conference gets over, and I'm standing in a bivocational pastor from Pocahontas, Arkansas. Anybody know where Pocahontas is? Somebody's from Pocahontas up here. We're glad to have you here at Cross Church today. It's awesome. And this brother was almost in tears as he talked to me about being a bivocational pastor. He's been a pastor, and he's worked in the medical community over the last few years during COVID. So, man, he's just beat down with just how tough life has been. He said, Nick, my church has 30 people in it, but we baptized 4 this year. I was like, that's incredible, man. And so I said, reach out to me. And he did. We got them connected, and he has joined the Cross Church Partner Family. Allows us to get to minister to just a small church pastor, bivocational pastor, and get to help them along the way. We're very, very excited about this. Our first partner church is actually our Neosho campus. A year ago, we told you that we were going to begin a process, and this has been a process that's been this last year, where we were going to launch our Neosho campus into their own independent, autonomous church, and that has happened and is in process of happening, and you're not going to believe what the Lord has done. Turn your attention to the screen one more time.
Good morning, church. Over the last 7 years, we have been partnered together in an incredible work of God right on the other side of the Missouri state line in the city of Neosho. In Easter 2014, we launched a campus in Neosho, and since that time, by God's grace, we've seen over 200 people saved and baptized in that church family. Last year, during the middle of the pandemic, we had the opportunity to really slow down and to prayerfully consider what is the future that God has for that campus. And we truly believe that that church, because of its spiritual health and its leadership, was positioned to launch into its own autonomous, independent church. And so we began to work toward that. Now, one of the main things that we needed in that whole process was a senior pastor to lead that transition. So we prayed for that, that God would raise up a man for that purpose. And by God's grace again, he did just that. In January of this last year, we got to welcome our new senior pastor for this campus, soon to be church, named Eric Green. And so I want to introduce you to Eric and allow him just to share a little bit about his story of coming to be part of Cross Church, but now what he believes that God is going to do with his future.
My wife and I were serving at First Baptist Boonville when Nick called with an idea, and it's something we prayed about and visited with you on several occasions, and there was just no doubt that that's what the Lord willed for us. And so we arrived on the scene, the church voted, and our first official Sunday was January 11th, and since, we've seen 32 following baptisms. We have two lined up for this Sunday, and we began with an attendance around 120, and 2 weeks ago we were at 341.
It's incredible,
so
man.
So it's just, I mean, for me, an affirmation, but also for Cross Church, and for you, Nick, and Jeff, to entrust something that Cross Church has invested so much in to my family and I, it was just a great honor and something that humbled us. And we live every day excited and amazed to have a small piece of such a significant investment by a church.
I know God's given you a vision, and even you guys have just recently launched your new name.
We've chosen Freedom Church. For freedom's sake, Christ set us free. And it's been a name that's resonated in our community and among our congregation. And so we have purchased 10 acres, and we are in the process of designing plans. And hopefully Easter this next year, we'll perform groundbreaking.
That's awesome, man. Well, as you can see, we truly believe that the best days for Neosho are still ahead. Because of your faithfulness, church, and because of your generosity, we at Cross Church were able to give a significant gift to Freedom Church that will help support them for this coming year. We want to make sure that they are supported as possible as they continue the mission of reaching Southwest Missouri, America, and the world for Jesus Christ.
Cross Church, I want to thank you so very much on behalf of my family, the staff, and our congregation. And as we march forward in a vision, just the freedom that gives us to focus on the ministry rather than making sure that worrying about the finances all the time. So I cannot tell you, to the staff and to the church, I can't tell you thank you enough.
Well, we're so grateful for you. I'll tell you this, church, I'm thankful to be part of a church that has opportunities like this. I believe that God smiles upon churches partnering together for the sake of the gospel, and we can't wait to do more of that. I hope that you will join with us. We truly are better together.
Isn't that a great story, church? And praise God. Well, even though they are, for the most part, operating on their own, we told them we would be in a 2-year financial agreement with them so that we just didn't push them out of the nest and they not be able to fly. And so we just finished year one. We are in that for another year, as Ryan mentioned, a significant financial amount that we will continue to help them. So here's the cool thing. Outside of the Decade of Love, when my family gives to the ministry budget, when your family gives to the ministry budget, not only are you supporting the work of Cross Church, you're supporting Freedom Church all the way up in Neosho, Missouri, a place you may never attend or even go to, but we're still helping that church get off the ground there. Now, let me talk about the offering specifically related to the E, okay? It's interesting when we just kind of throw it out there, okay, Lord, we want to be a church that encourages and equips pastors and missionaries what God drops in our lap, okay? So today we're giving towards 4 separate things that God has brought about. The first one is what we call our Called to Lead Conference. This is something that just came about on a whim. We literally pulled this together in about 3 weeks during COVID to try to minister to other churches. And we did it again this past year. And next year it is our plan to bring that in person. We really see this as an opportunity for us to reach out to local smaller churches in Arkansas, Oklahoma, Missouri. And we've done that totally online the last 2 years. And this is wild what God's done with it. We've been able to minister to over 8,000 unique church leaders representing 44 states and 29 nations through Called to Lead. And so it's just just a miracle. I mean, just literally on a whim, Sean Smith threw it out. We should do something online right now when everybody's locked down, and we did it, and man, God has just taken it and just blown it up. The second is what we're just calling a pastor's conference. The actual name of this conference is called Mega Metro. This is a retreat, really a little mini conference for pastors and wives of the largest SBC churches in our convention. And so that rotates who's in charge, just whatever reason. Last year I got elected as the leader of that, which just flows right into our vision to equip and encourage pastors. And so I'll lead that this April. We'll be giving towards just investing in pastors in that manner. The third, I've got to be vague, and I'm vague on purpose, okay? But you can read through the lines on why I'm doing that. We have a global partner training event, okay? And for safety, I'm not going to give a lot of details. But we've been asked to lead a training overseas for over 700 people who are giving their life to reach people in hard-to-reach places. You getting where I'm headed with that? So I can't even say from the stage where it's going to be or where these people do their work, but you can tell that where I'm headed. Okay, everybody got that? And here's what I need from you, church. We got three campuses watching right now. I need at least 160 of you to join me in this trip overseas. It's this summer, and if you want more information on that, you can go at any of the campuses to the missions kiosk out in the lobbies, or you can just call the missions office, and we will give you more information about where that is, the dates, and we're gonna have the opportunity to reach 700 overseas workers and encourage and invest in them and in their kids. It's such a blessing that God's given us. The last is what we're calling a partner family weekend. These 22 pastors that represent these churches, we want to bring them in here and love on them and invest in them and pour into them and then send them back into their churches. And so we're going to bring them in for a weekend to be able to do that, okay? So that's what we're giving towards related to the E in this offering. Now let me wrap up, okay? Can we all agree I just gave you a lot of information? I'm tired, and I'm sure you're tired, okay? Can I sum it up and boil it down to one statement? You're a part of a church reaching Northwest Arkansas, America, and the world for Jesus Christ. You really are. And you're a great church. You really are. Here's my encouragement to us. Today we have an opportunity to accelerate the vision, to push it forward. And like I said, I believe what happens in these rooms today will create the margin and the space to something we're not even thinking about in the future. We can say yes immediately because God has provided the funds. Today is a part of that. It's time to plant some things in the ground for later. I want us to pray together as we wrap up today. And I'm gonna give you just a moment to just have just a moment with the Lord with every head bowed, every eye closed. And today, if you're here, man, maybe you've even prepared for this day. Man, we've been talking as a family, or I've worked through this personally, and I'm ready to give today. I'm about to give you that opportunity. There are others who you may say, Nick, I walked in this room with one amount in mind, and man, God's burdened my heart to do more. You know, that was my story in this journey, by the way. Meredith and I talked, and we had decided what we were going to give. I finished the message, and after reading through it, I thought, man, I think we might need to do more. I sat on it for a couple of days. Just this week, I said, Meredith, do you think that we're doing what we need to do? You think we're doing as much as we need to? And we talked, and we upped our own giving. Sacrificial giving. God loves a cheerful giver. And God gives us an opportunity to do that today. Would you just have a moment with the Lord? Lord, we trust you. We look at a story like JD's story, and we realize that things that we're doing today matter decades from now. Investing in kids today matters. Lord, we pray that you'd raise up the next Billy Graham from this church the next Elizabeth Elliott from this church and many others who would make massive differences for the gospel. Lord, today we give in faith, we trust that you can do more than we can do on our own. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Well, today when you walked in, you received this blue brochure. I'd love for you to grab that right now. And if you'll look on the back of that, it explains there are 5 different ways that you can give today. And on every seat in every worship center, we have the legacy offering. This is Meredith and I's check right here that we put in an offering envelope today. And you'll see the other options. You can give online at our website. There's a QR code if you'd rather do it that way. You can give through the app, which the app is a great way to just stay involved. Do you wonder, you ever wonder why I don't wear the same thing back-to-back weeks, how that happens? I look at the app almost every Sunday morning, and I look back at the video, and I say, oh, I wear that. I'll wear this week. Just a little side note. If you would say, Nick, I just want to make it simple. I've got my debit or credit card. Where can I go? There will be an orange tent in every lobby today where you can go. They've got a place you can swipe, tell them how much you want to do, and they will get you involved. I'm going to take my envelope to Pinnacle. I guess I'll turn it in at Pinnacle today after the service there. And but here's what I want to be clear with. When you exit today at every campus, there will be a bin where you can place the legacy envelope in there. If you are just saying, Nick, I'm just giving my tithe today, separate from that, you can give that in the normal envelope, or maybe you give that online. Meredith and I do the direct deposit thing for our tithe right out of our check. If you're giving cash, here's what I want to just be clear about. Anything you put in the bin that is in the normal offering envelope or is cash will go straight to the ministry budget. That's the lifeblood. That's what keeps us going as a church. If you are giving anything to the legacy offering, it needs to go in here or distributed through one of these ways. That makes sense, everybody? So thank you, church. And I can't wait to share with you next week what God has done. And we are believing that God's going to do a major, major work today. So y'all pray for us as we head to Pinnacle. At the close of our service today, obviously today's just a different kind of day entirely. Our campus pastors can go ahead and make their way to the front of each stage. And after we dismiss, if you're here today, you say, Nick, I need to talk to somebody. I need prayer for something in my life. I need to talk to somebody about a relationship with Jesus Christ. Our staff at all 3 is going to be lined up across the front, and you can come and you can talk to them, and we'll pray with you, talk with you about anything going on in your life, okay? Church, we love you. Y'all have a great day. We'll see you next Sunday.